Hello and welcome to an explanation of Rust's lifetime concept. The notion of a lifetime seems weirdly foreign to anyone who's used any other programming language. As someone who has used data, you probably have become familiar with data types. We encode numbers as floating point or text as strings. But the idea of associating a lifetime with something that is inanimate or isn't alive, like a variable, doesn't seem to make any sense. The next few minutes, I'm going to try to explain what Rust means by the term lifetime so that you can gain an intuition and hopefully an appreciation for that concept. Programs in Rust start with main. I'll use this line to denote the execution of a function. And so here is my main. At the moment, I'm doing no work. I start by assigning a to the value 100. And I might want to call another function, let's say work. And inside work, I want to refer back to the original a. And so I use the ampersand syntax to say I want a reference to an integer, an I32, or an integer with 32 bits, or 4 bytes wide. And here it is as a variable inside work. And conceptually, I point to the A. I create another variable. We want to add the initial value, which was created in main, to 900 and assign that to some new value. And let's just say conceptually, I wanted to be able to refer back to that last result, like sort of the last value. I want to refer back to B, which was created within work. So I say, oh, look, I'll create another reference. I do this by returning a reference from the work function. And inside main, you can see I pass in my reference and then I get B underscore ref. At least that's what I think I want to happen. But Rust complains very quickly that this is an illegal operation. It says that we can't return a reference to a local variable. And that's because when work finishes, there is no variable to refer to. Rust's lifetime concept is encoding that in the type system, is encoding the possibility that references to data might end. And in fact, we'll check that it is impossible to ever refer to data that is invalid or in an uninitialized state. So you can't refer to something before it has been created. If I want to fix the problem, I've got a few options. Let's go back to the original. One of the things I could do is kind of find some extra space that isn't in work and put the result of adding 900 into that space. And let's call that the heap. And I can create values on the heap with a box. Box is a term that computer scientists use for referring to data that has been allocated outside of the scope of a local variable inside of a function. This is, for example, how Java or maybe a Python or JavaScript will store almost every value somewhere on this space in memory called the heap. But what if I really wanted to return a reference? There is a sort of an escape hatch that I can do. I could, what is known as a leak the box, which means that I disassociate the ownership of the underlying data to any given function, and the heap exists it's sort of guaranteed to exist for the lifetime of the program. It will live, the data will live as long as the program lives. And in fact, it will continue to exist and carry on past main finishing. The way to pass a value to this heap and then keep it there forever is with this term leak, which returns you back a reference with the so-called static lifetime. When you see the static lifetime in Rust, what you're saying is that you have a reference to something that will exist for the remainder of the program. There are some other options to get around this. We could, for example, decide that we want to modify the original A, and in which case I'll add the mutation keyword to the original value A, and then use the dereference operator, the star, to say that I'm actually attempting to modify the original value A, and that will actually be modified to 1000. Cool. Well, I hope that this has been a fun and kind of like an interesting discussion about what lifetimes mean in Rust. And if this has been a useful exercise for you, or and you've learned something, please do subscribe and suggest any other videos that you would like. I'm more than happy to explore other areas of the language.